want you to consider just a moment that you're in your house at night, asleep, when a person comes to your home with the intent to do you harm. He approaches your house, he sees a window that he's able to open and climb in undetected. He creeps down the hallway and into your bedroom. As he moves up silently to where you're asleep, you open your eyes and you see this person there. Now, in that moment, before the act is carried out, what is the one thing that you need most of all? Now, I'm sure there's lots of things to consider, but I'd argue the one thing that you need most of all is time. Had you had time, the outcome would be much different. Now, consider the other way. Consider that you're home, again, asleep, and when you get notified that in 10 minutes, someone's going to be coming to your house with the intent to do you harm. What could you do in those 10 minutes? How would the outcome have changed if you had 10 minutes to prepare for the arrival of that person? So what we're talking about really is surprise and the manipulation of time. And in this video, we're going to talk about how to use time to achieve surprise and how to manipulate it for us to win. Now, surprise is talked about a lot of military manuals, a lot of books. In fact, it's mentioned in the characteristics of the offense in FM30. If you remember, in the characteristics of the offense, or how I like to look at it, is what the offense should look like. Should have audacity, boldness, right? Aggressiveness. Should have concentration, concentrate effects. I like to think of that as combined arms. We've talked a lot about that. Should have tempo. Purposes of our baton, we talk about racing, right? Moving faster than your opponent. And you should have surprise. Well, how do you achieve surprise? How do you achieve surprise is through the manipulation of time. I think this will kind of clarify it. So Robert Leonard points out that every military organization, from the tank crew up into the field army, spends most of its time unready for combat. Now, I'm not sure you hear that and you're like, well, that's not me. I'm always ready for combat. I'm ready all the time. But what he really means is, think about when you're in a training environment, any kind of operation. How much of that operation truly is spent in your assault position, all lined up, locked and loaded, right? Sighted in, the right equipment, and you're ready to launch your attack. Or on the defense, that you're in your fighting position, your sector stakes are out, you have enfilade fire, and you're ready to go, awaiting for the approach of the enemy. Of the life cycle, of a training life cycle, or an operation life cycle, how much of the time is spent arrayed like that? Very little. But the myth that you have to understand is, so is the enemy. Just as we are perpetually unready to fight, so is the enemy. Perpetually unready to fight. And this is what this diagram kind of is supposed to show, and I don't know if you can read all the small words there, but really this kind of just depicts an operations life cycle. Here's the dark rifles and here's the enemy. And any kind of operation life cycle, we have time that we're spent moving up roads, time in unfavorable terrain where we're kind of muddling around, time getting loading up and getting ready to go, time refitting, eating, sleeping, getting fixing ourselves after the operation. There's plans and orders time. There's rehearsing time. There's reorganization time. There's time when we're lost and delayed. But actually, of this operation life cycle, very little of it is when we are there ready to fight. But what's important to understand, the enemy is in the same life cycle. They too have time when they're moving up roads. Time when they're in unfavorable terrain, or when they're loading up, or when they're refitting, and then when they're rehearsing, and so on and so forth, and very little of their time, they are ready to fight. Now, unfortunately, a training scar that we have is when we go out to these stick lanes or company stick lanes or training events, we always wait to attack when our opponent is ready to fight. Realizing that in the life cycle of operations, that's kind of deceptive, because most of the time, each of us are not ready to fight. So knowing that we're both perpetually unready for combat, how do we make that transition from unready to ready? Well, I'd argue it's time. Which what's more important is but how much. Really, it's all about a battle for detection. Let me show you what I mean. In this diagram, here we have the enemy. The enemy is moving along to attack us. Here we are in our defensive battle position. And just for simplicity, let's say we're separated by 8 kilometers. Now, I'm not going to get into weapons ranges and how far out they would shoot and all that, just for simplicity's sake. So if the enemy was moving at 20 kilometers per hour, which is pretty quick, and we're separated by 8 kilometers, that means the enemy would be upon us from their position around 24 minutes, because at 20 kilometers per hour, for every kilometer, it takes 3 minutes. Maybe we're able to slow them down to a more sluggish 10 kilometers per hour. That means that for every kilometer, it takes them 6 minutes. Therefore, 8 kilometers away from where they are, just standing on top of us, it would take us 42 minutes. Now imagine, though, this doesn't really matter if the enemy makes its approach undetected. Let's say they're not detected until they're 1 kilometer out. That would mean for us, we would have 3 minutes to transition from all the things we discussed earlier about our operations life cycle, transition from planning and operations, rehearsing, refitting, reorganized, transition from that state into a ready to fight for our life condition. 3 minutes, probably not enough time. But let's say we were able to detect them much earlier. At 7 kilometers, we detect that they're en route. That would then give us, at 20 kilometers per hour, 21 minutes to prepare. Maybe we're able to slow them down. At 10 kilometers per hour, if they're traveling, that would give us 42 minutes to prepare. Imagine being notified in 42 minutes, you will have to fight for your life. It's much different if you were then given 3 minutes. Now, let's turn it around. Let's see how we could use this in the offense. Let's say we're now in the attack. Again, 8 kilometers away. If we were able to move in such a way and to delay the enemy's detection, and they're not detected until we're about less than 3/4 of a kilometer out, that would give them 2 minutes to prepare. 2 minutes to prepare. Now, like I said earlier, most likely they are in a condition different than a ready-to-fight condition. And that is how you achieve surprise. It's about delaying detection, and upon, once you understand you've been detected, the enemy knows you're coming, then you have to race and hasten contact. So in this whole scenario, it's a battle. Who can detect each other the first? The battlefield has become an interaction between perpetual unreadiness and time. What does that mean? That means that in order to get stuff done, you can't be at 100% security all the time. Because once you go into a high level of security and everyone's ready to fight, well, then vehicles aren't getting fixed. Orders are not being issued. Plans are not being developed. And we're not loading and moving out. So how do we balance having a state of unreadiness where we're able to get things done, but yet being able to detect a threat in order to help us transition from inaction to ready to fight? Well, a technique that was used in times past that we're going to rely on heavily is this use of LPOPs. And I want to bring this to your attention because oftentimes, you know, we see soldiers and folks are pulling security. They call it pulling security. You know, what that really means is someone standing there behind a tree and he's looking out into nothing and, you know, okay, great. So what we're doing is very different than that. We're going to rely on what they call LPOPs, listening post observation post. Listening. You're listening for the threat. Observing. You're observing for the threat. And you're on a position where you can see far enough away and you're out far enough away to provide early detection. Understand that's critical, because the further out that you can detect the threat, the more time you buy us to transition from inaction to action. So if you're assigned as an LPOP, you've got to be good at what you do. And this is what we need. I need you to be able to detect the enemy at night using thermals, using all the capabilities that we have, being able to detect the enemy. You have to be able to communicate their location and what are they intending to do. You have to be able to call for fire. The benefit if you call for fire is it's less likely to give away your position. If you start shooting, then the muzzle flash, you give away your position. If you get on the radio and call for fire, then we're able to respond and keep you in concealed location. And lastly, guide the counterattack. So how we're going to utilize and how we're going to balance our need to get stuff done and security is by the use of LPOPs. Soldiers are going to be dedicated to this task to get up on high ground, far enough away to see far enough where they can detect the enemy at such a distance to buy us time so we can rapidly transition from inaction to fight for our life. In the offense, what we're trying to do is we must be able to delay detection as long as possible. Get as close as we can, without the enemy knowing it. And that's enabled to take advantage of this time. At some point, we're going to be detected. And after at that moment, then we have to hasten contact. But remember, understand the enemy most likely, like everyone else, is perpetually unready. And if we can delay detection, then once detected, then we catch them in that transition between ready and in ready. And that's how you achieve surprise. Now, the best form of maneuver, I think, that describes that is infiltration. Now, infiltration means is that you break apart and you move along in small units, undetected, through the enemy's area, and then you link back up at an ORP and consolidate, and then attack the enemy from behind. Think of War of the Ants, right? You move undetected in small units, link back up, and attack the enemy from behind. Really, it's the gold standard in infantry. I mean, think of the Battle of Way, 1968. The NVA and the Viet Cong, what they pulled off was incredible. Moving undetected into the city and then launching the attack from the inside out. So that's what we're trying to do as a battalion, right? Is to take advantage of this time flank, to be able to take advantage of perpetual unreadiness of the enemy, and to really to mitigate our own is our use of LPOPs and our ability to conduct an infiltration. So, infiltrate to win. That's how we conduct our offense in order to take advantage of time. And with that, hunt, race, kill. Yeah.